Feeling of an emotion is a process that is distinct from having the emotion in the first place. So in order to understand what is an emotion, what is a feeling, we need to understand what is an emotion. And an emotion is the execution of a very complex program of actions. Some actions that are actually movements, like movement that you can do, change your face, for example, in fear, or movements that are internal, that happen in your heart or in your gut, and movements that are actually not muscular movements, but rather releases of molecules, say, for example, in the endocrine system, into the bloodstream. But it's movement and action in the broad sense of the term. And an emotion consists of a very well-orchestrated set of alterations in the body that has, as a general purpose, making life more survivable by taking care of a danger or taking care of an opportunity, either or something in between. And it's something that is set in our genome and that we all have with a certain programmed nature that is modified by our experience. So individually we have variations on the pattern, but in essence, your emotion of joy and mine are going to be extremely similar. We may express them physically slightly differently, and it's of course graded depending on the circumstance, but the essence of the process is going to be the same, unless one of us is not quite well put together and is missing something. Otherwise, it's going to be the same. And it's going to be the same across even other species. You know, there's a... you know, we may smile and the dog may wag the tail, but in essence, we have a set program, and those programs are similar across individuals in the species. Then the feeling is actually a portrayal of what is going on in the organism when you're having an emotion. So it's really the next thing that happens. If you have just an emotion, you would not necessarily feel it. To feel an emotion, you need to represent in the brain, in structures that are actually different from the structures which lead to the emotion, what is going on in the organism when you're having the emotion. So you can define it very simply as the process of perceiving what is going on in the organism when you are in the throes of an emotion. And that is achieved by a collection of structures, some of which are in the brainstem and some of which are in the cerebral cortex, namely the insular cortex, which I like to mention not because I think it's the most important. I actually don't think it's the number one structure controlling our feelings, but I like to mention it because it's something that people didn't really know about, and many years ago, which probably now are going close to 20 years ago, I thought that the insula would be an important platform for feelings. That's where I started. And there was a hypothesis, and turns out that the hypothesis is perfectly correct. And 10 years ago, we had the first experiments that showed that it was indeed so. And since then, countless studies have shown that when you're having feelings of emotion or feelings of a variety of other things, the insula is active. But it doesn't mean that it's the only thing that is active. And there are other structures that are very important as well. Well, you see, emotion, very often when you think about how you react to the world, you know, something is happening to you. You're simply going along and you're being confronted by different things, not necessarily very important or significance for your ultimate life, but you are constantly reacting to the world. You're thinking about the world and you're acting on the world. And emotions are engaged when the stakes outside of your organism are fairly high in positive or negative directions. And this, of course, comes from ancient times in biology when you were constantly being subject to potential threats into potential opportunities. The threats were obvious, for example, predation, or inclement weather, or physical environments where you would be like having a precipice or a hole on the ground. The opportunities are also very easy to see. They would have fundamentally to do with food and with sex. And so the emotions were placed there in evolution as incredibly smart devices that, rather than having you think through the problem, would deliver a solution and make sure that you would act right. It's in a way a contribution to a sort of our autopilot that we've inherited through all these millions of years of evolution. So if there is an opportunity, the emotion is going to make sure that you, at some level, know that it's there and that you're going to have the tendency to act on it. And if there is a threat, you're going to be alerted to it. And even before you're alerted to the threat as such, you're going to be placed in circumstances that are likely to make you either freeze or run away from the danger. Okay? So this is a level of response to the world that is automated. It's largely non-conscious. I mean, it happens non-conscious. Then you take consciousness of it, because once it's happening, once you start feeling what is happening and connecting the feeling to what you're perceiving, then you realize, ha-ha, there's the danger, or ha-ha, here's the next lunch. And so there is a level in which you have a way in which the entire process then is made conscious and enters your mind flow. Even at this level, you can see that the influence on one's behavior is astounding, and it's by and large extremely useful. It has, of course, its downsides, because you may be responding to things that you better not respond to, either on the negative or positive side, and that you should not take the bait. You should not, for example, fall for every opportunity, and you should not allow yourself to be made angry, for example, or fearful, when there is no cause for it. But there is a way in which, by and large, the influence is very positive. And then the experiences of emotion also have a way of modeling what you're going to do next, because unlike, say, a squirrel, who is not going to think much about his or her experiences of emotion, we do. And we have, because we have feelings, because those feelings can actually stay in memory in terms of the elaborations that we make about the feelings, for example, using language, then we have a possibility of using feelings of certain emotions for future planning. And that makes a huge difference. So for a little animal that doesn't have much mind and no advanced planning, it's a way of keeping alive. For animals like us, it's a way of keeping alive sometimes, but an even better way of constructing a view of the world and making sure that that view is taken into consideration when we plan future events.